Each of us humans like stories. In fact, we love stories. But why and how do we seem to love them? For science, that may still be a puzzle. Nevertheless, our understanding of the human mind leads the way to the insight, which streams in the backdrop while we are immersed in a story and our mind is processing, forming connections, feeling emotions, rewiring neural pathways and churning information presented to us through the story. The Storytelling Animal by Jonathan Gottschall takes us through an immersive worldscape that is peppered with oodles of metaphors, pointers, insights and lessons pertaining mostly to the topic of storytelling. The book features an interesting embroidery woven together with the intricate threads of researches related to evolutionary psychology, neuroscience, and various other sciences. Encapsulating several stories within stories and pop modern terminology, the book delves deep into some of the fundamental concepts and quintessential elements that make up the overall idea of storytelling. In this review, I am going to share with you 18 interesting pointers that I learned and curated after reading the book, basically my primary takeaways from the book. So let's get started with these. Number 1. The origin of storytelling. Storytelling is not some new age science, but rather it is as old as the existence of life itself on earth. Mr. Jonathan says that the human beings are creatures of an imaginative realm called Neverland. He also says that the primate version of human was not merely Homo sapiens but also Homo fictus, that is the great ape with the storytelling mind. And long before any of these primates thought of writing Hamlet or Harley Quinn's or Harry Potter stories, long before these primates could envision writing at all, they thronged around hearth fires, trading wild lies about brave tricksters and young lovers, selfless heroes and shrewd hunters and chiefs and wise crones. The origin of the sun and the stars, the nature of God and spirit and all the rest of it. Number 2. The scientific view of fiction. The book describes how bringing science into fiction is not the best suited thing to do. We should not do intellectual dissection of fiction, as Wordsworth also said, to dissect is to murder. However, this doesn't at all mean that fiction is by any means in conflict with science. Fiction, as a matter of fact, is deeply rooted in science. It enables the reader to envision new and creative ideas by requiring their willing suspension of disbelief. The main thing Mr. Jonathan writes is to pry away the veneer of familiarity and to accept the bizarreness and strangeness of the story worlds as they really are. Fictions, fantasies, dreams, these are to the humanistic imagination a kind of sacred preserve. They are the last bastion of magic, they are the one place where science cannot, should not, penetrate. Reducing ancient mysteries to electrochemical storms in the brain or the timeless warfare among selfish genes. Number 3. Humans are addicted to stories. We as human species are addicted to stories. Of all, there are three main reasons to that. First, we can't resist the gravity of the alternate worlds. Second, our mind is addicted to patterns. The human mind is tuned to detect patterns. The same mental software that makes us very alert to human faces and figures causes us to see animals in clouds or Jesus in griddle marks. This is part of the mind design that helps us perceive meaningful patterns in our environment. Our hunger for meaningful patterns translates into our hunger for stories. Thirdly, humans conjure gods, spirits and spirits to fill the explanatory voids. What we don't understand, that's a story. Number 4. Reader's imagination is the catalyst for the storyteller. Writers and storytellers merely create storyscapes, but it's the reader's imagination that acts as a catalyst, churning the received information into an experience. Number 5. Writing is analogous to painting. Each word is a daub of paint. Word by word, brushstroke by brushstroke, the writer creates images that have all the depth and crispness of real life. But writers are merely drawing, not painting. Our minds supply most of the information in the scene, most of the color, shading, and texture. Children are natural storytellers. Number 6. Kids and children, what do? Mr. Jonathan writes that they do story mostly. The world of make-believe and pretend play is spontaneous and natural to children. They don't need to be taught how to create stories. They are natural storytellers. And even though we may grow up into full-fledged adults, but this inner child prevails within us. We are all more like Peter Pan than we know. We may leave the nursery with the toy trucks and dress-up clothes, but we never stop pretending. We just change how we do it. Novels, dreams, films, and fantasies are provinces of Neverland. Number 7. Stories dominate our life. Stories' role in human life extends far beyond conventional novels or films. Story and a variety of story-like activities dominates human life. From the skills we learn to the conversations we have with people, stories dominate nearly every aspect of our life. And it's not only the writers and storytellers and filmmakers who tell stories, but everybody, including archaeologists, business executives, political commentators, and all. We are soaked to the bone in story. Human mind was shaped for story so that it could be shaped by story. The reason for this could be that stories universally focus on the great predicaments of human condition. Stories where people go to practice the key skills of human social life. They help us with real-world problem-solving, and like a flight simulator, fiction projects us into simulations of problems that run parallel to those we face in reality. And like a flight simulator, the main virtue of fiction is that we have a rich experience and don't die at the end. We get to simulate what it would be like to confront a dangerous man or seduce someone's spouse, for instance, and the hero of the story dies in our stead. Number 8. Stories and repetition. Repetition of fictional problem solving enhances the skill of real life problem solving too. Number 9. Hell is story friendly. Mr. Jonathan points out a brilliant insight pertaining to stories. That is, there is a huge difference in desirability between what we desire in real life and what is desired in stories. He writes, there is a yawning canyon between what is desirable in life, such as an uneventful trip to the grocery store, and what is desirable in fiction, a catastrophic trip. In this gap, I believe, lies an important clue to the evolutionary riddle of fiction. While in real world we may not like to face conflicts and dilemmas and troubles, in the matter of storytelling, conflicts, dilemmas, and troubles make the bread and jam of stories. In life, conflict often carries a negative connotation. Yet, in fiction, be it comic or tragic, dramatic conflict is fundamental. Because in literature, only trouble is interesting. Only trouble is interesting. This is not so in life. As Charles Baxter puts it in another book of fiction, hell is story-friendly. However, this doesn't at all imply that fiction is absolutely an escapist entertainment. An escapist entertainment is meant to be pleasant. On the flip side, a good fiction is far than pleasant. Instead, it is webbed with the tentacles of conflict and drama. Number 10. Practical people, story people, and the riddle of fiction. The book mentions the metaphor of two groups of people, practical people and story people. Story people fill their leisure time with rest, gossip and stories, but practical people don't waste their time on stories. They keep on working for their bellies. The story people prevail more often than the practical people, and this is the great riddle of fiction. Number 11. Even music tells stories. Of course, not all music tells a story. There are also symphonies, fugues and avant-garde soundscapes, blending wind chimes and bunny screams. But the most popular brand of music tells stories about protagonists struggling to get what they want, most often a boy or a girl. Singers might work in meter and rhyme and alongside guitarists and drummers, but that doesn't alter the fact that the singer is telling a story. It only disguises it. Number 12. Daydreaming, fantasies and imagination. The witchery of life. Daydreams are hard to study scientifically, but if you tune into your stream of consciousness, you'll discover that daydreaming is mind's default state. We spend half of our waking hours, one third of our lives on earth, spinning fantasies. We daydream about the past, things we should have said or done, working through our victories and failures. We daydream about mundane stuff such as different ways of handling conflict at work. But we also daydream in a much more intense story-like way. We screen films with happy endings in our minds where all our wishes, vain, aggressive, dirty, come true. And we screen little horror films too, in which our worst fears are realized. Imagination is an awesome mental tool. While our bodies are always locked in a specific here and now, our imagination frees us to roam space-time. Like powerful sorcerers, all humans can see the future, not a clear and determined future, but a murky probabilistic one. Number 13. Character creation is a natural talent. Good fiction means skillfully crafted characters. Mr. Jonathan writes that character creation is an innate process that we begin learning while we are still a kiddo. Two-year-olds begin learning how to develop a character. When playing the king, they pitch their voices differently than when they are playing the queen or the mewing cat. Number 14. Story structure is the bony skeleton and the universal grammar. Mr. Jonathan says in the book that stories, nearly all stories, follow a pattern of structures. Every story is confined to this structural pattern. Think of this structure as a bony skeleton that we rarely notice beneath the padding of flesh and colorful garments. This skeleton is somewhat cartilaginous. There is a flex in it, but the flex is limited and the skeleton dictates that stories can be told in a limited number of ways. This, however, at first may appear to be a limitation in the way of a writer or a storyteller, but these structural constraints actually free the writer or the storyteller to tell their stories more expressively. The idea that stories slavishly obey deep structural patterns seems at first vaguely depressing, but it shouldn't be. Think of the human face. The fact that all faces are much alike doesn't make the face boring or mean that particular faces can't startle in with their beauty or distinctiveness. As William James wrote, "There is a very little difference between one man and another, but what little there is, it is very important." The same is true for stories. Patterns of complication, crisis and resolution, a universal grammar, a deep pattern. Human brain and fiction. How does the human brain respond to the stimulus of fiction? Well, to understand this, we would need to understand the basics of the mind design. How our brain is designed. There are neurons firing information and linking with each other to form connections. Then there are certain type of neurons called as the mirror neurons. When we read or watch a work of fiction, these mirror neurons cause our brain to respond to it as if the fiction was happening in real life. Knowing that fiction is fiction doesn't stop our emotional brain from processing it as real. When we see something scary or dangerous in a film, our brain lights up as though that thing were happening to us, not just to a cinematic figment. We feel what the protagonist is feeling, and that is stupendous, isn't it? Well, moving on. Number 16. Dreams, night stories, and alternate dimension of reality. Driven by the rule of fight or flight, the dreaming consciousness is a form of nature storytelling. In the book, Mr. Jonathan writes that dreams are the night stories with their own plot, setting, scenes, point of view, characters, perspective, and theme. Dreams are encrypted messages from the spirit, or in Freudian terms, from the ID. While the body lies dormant, the restless brain improvises original drama in the theater of our minds. Number 17. Ink people. They change the world. Using the metaphor of ink people for storytellers, Mr. Jonathan says in the book, "The characters in fiction are just wiggles of ink on paper. They are ink people. They live in ink houses inside ink towns. They work at ink jobs. They have inky problems. They sweat ink and they cry ink. And when they are cut, they bleed ink. And yet, ink people press effortlessly through the porous membrane separating their inky words from ours. They move through our flesh and blood world and wield real power to it. They shape our behaviors and our customs, and in doing so, they transform societies and histories." Number 18. Story is the glue of the world. Story is the grease and the glue of society. Story is the center without which the rest cannot hold. Taking the example of a movie, Mr. Jonathan explains that if the movie is good, people watch it as a single organism. They laugh together, they gasp together, they react to the movie together as if in a psychic unity. And this way, story ends up binding people together. Fiction writers mix the powder of a message with the sugary jam of storytelling. People bowl down the sweet jam of storytelling and don't even notice the undertaste of the powder. In a nutshell, whether you are a writer or a storyteller or just an avid reader, I hope that you love stories, because I do and you should too. Thank you.